topics for this lecture. I thought to propose you also for this network of schools and countries involved in this international PhD program. I decided to propose you that is urbanist. I propose to you this kind of reflection. I'll start from the case study of Bergamo to propose you an inductive path through the urban planning practice of this city that is a medium-sized city in Italy, in Lombardy, northern Italy. For what? For a design internal history in urbanism. I mean an internal history of urban planning project in our practices. My commitment in fact was this one, to provide a contribution about the history of Italian urban planning in the 20th century, and I decided to try to address this this challenge in this short lecture, about 1 hour, focusing first of all on this aspect, on this need. In my opinion, urbanism today needs an internal history. What I mean, the necessity of a reflection, a specific reflection about the ways of doing urban plans, a history of design practices in urbanism. I mean deepening a reflection about the themes, the techniques and the tools involved in this practice through the time, over time. And in the top of this slide, I put this this sentence: the history of urbanism certainly cannot be written only as an internal history, but it is ridiculous when it is written exclusively in terms of external history. This is not a sentence of mine, it's a sentence of one of the main Italian urbanists of the second half of the last century. He passed away in 2014, that is Bernardo Secchi. And this this sentence is cited by the book Prima Lezione di Urbanistica, first lecture, first lesson in urban planning, in urbanism. And I totally agree with this point. So we cannot explain urbanism, urban planning practices, just trying referring to the history with the capital H letter, so the history of our countries, of our societies, of our economic and political conditions. But there is a linkage between internal history of urbanism and general history of our countries, but there is also a specificity that we need to deepen. An inductive strategy, looking at the planning practices of a city over time. This method, this trick, this way of looking at urbanism, in my opinion, allows us to have a deeper contact with urbanism, urban planning in the making, a more direct and less abstract relationship with urban planning, and so afar from an academic planning theory, but a more involving way of viewing a point of view from inside urban plans and their reasons. Because planning is a very practical discipline. Something more about this strategy, and then we are ready to pass through, above all, images of urban planning tradition of the city of Bergamo. A monographic look from a place, from the series of plans of a city, allows us to recognize the evolution of what? First of all, of the thematic focuses of that place, urbanism over time. So, what are the themes in the internal history of a place? The internal history of urbanism of a place. And looking at themes of the specific internal history in planning of a place, we can recognize themes that are very strictly related to the place, site-specific, rooted in the place, and belonging to a specific context. And on the other hand, there are some of these themes that are instead representative of a more general urban planning phase of that country, and so on. So themes, and on the other way, on the other hand, technical ways of doing urban planning. And what is interesting, passing through the series of plans of the city over time, is to recognize the change of technical ways, both in the interpretation of themes over time and in the treatment. So this is the introduction. These are the premises of my speech. But now we are ready to address this case study, starting from the pre-modern condition of this little city, Bergamo, that is a very, very a singular kind of city, because in its origin it was a three-polar city. It revealed a singular three-polar urban form. What are the ingredients of this urban form? The walled city that is put on the hills, that is Bergamo Alta. Today, Bergamo Alta, the walls of Bergamo Alta are a UNESCO site. And then we have two original urban nuclei in the plain of this area. But there is another very, very singular ingredient of this three-polar city, is, let me see, a regional facility of that time, a regional facility in the middle of these three poles, that was the ancient fair plant. The fair for a regional exchange of goods from the countryside, that was a real economic engine of that regional area. Till the mid 18th century, it was really active. This is the fair plant. This is the walled city, and this is one of these two villages in the plain, a linear settlement along the main streets, and this is the second. One, two, three, and the ancient fair of Bergamo in the middle. Some decades later, we are in the initial part of the 19th century, the structure of this city is very clear. So the old city, the ancient walled city, and the two villages, and the fair in the middle. One step more, we are at the end of the 19th century. There is a novelty here, the railway and the station. And so something is changing in the main relationships. This was the main road, the so-called sentierone, the big path of the city. That was the connection between the plain villages with the fair. And now there is this novelty that is the railway station. And here you can appreciate the presence of the old city that was the real core, administrative core, the municipality was up the hills. And some decades later, three decades later, also the funicular railway that in this map is missing, but in this following map is present. This is the funicular that links together the ancient city on the hills with the plain. And so we have an axis that brings us from the old city through the fair side to the station, and we have this cross of streets that is the new framework of the urbanization system. And this is a map of 1905 with that is a map of the current situation at that date, but with superimposed some main roads planned by the urban plan for the city of the beginning of the new century. And what is interesting, this colonization process of the void in the middle of this plain. But now I'm going to illustrate this process to you. Three phases through the 20th century. Making the modern city step one, making the modern city step two, and restructuring the contemporary city, that is the third phase that accompanies us through the 20th century. Just a few demographical data, census of population through the decade, starting from about 45,000 inhabitants. With an increasing population at the beginning of the new century, and then after the Second World period, the boosting process in the population increase, and then the peak in 1971, and then population starts to decrease in the municipal boundaries. It's the graphical representation is interesting. You can appreciate this trend of population through the decades, with the peak of 1971. It's very, very typical. Also in the city of Milan, my city, the 1971, about the census data, was the peak of the municipal population. And it's the same in the city of Bergamo. And so a first phase, modernization one, a second phase, modernization two, and then another phase, restructuring the contemporary city. What we named as the postmodern phase is another kind of planning challenge. Modernization of Bergamo phase one is made by a parallel tracks, the construction of the new city and the rearrangement of the old one. Let me say three planning teams and two obsessions for the city. First team, the expansion of the city, the ensanche. But it's a very, very strange ensanche. It's a very, very strange expansion because is expansion from inside, from colonizing and filling in the internal void of the original three poles, urban poles of the city. The in-between space of these three poles is the protagonist of this urban phase, in strict connection with the realization of the new city center, the so-called Centro Piacentiniano, because it was designed, the urban scene was designed, the prospects, the new fronts of buildings of this new city center were designed by Marcello Piacentini. And finally, and this is the first obsession, the new city center, and the second is the old city recovery. So what to do, what to deal with the old city, the world city. Urban sanitation, urban fabric clearance, safeguarding, and so on. Let's pass through the new city center. This is the final step of the new city center. The new city center were realized on the site of the ancient fair. The fair was working until the middle of 18th century. Then it started to decay through the time. And already in the 19th century, it was not so well working. It was really decommissioned. And so the idea was to substitute the fair plant with the new city, the new CBD of the city, the new city center on the site of the fair of Bergamo. And this is the final plan. The municipal approval is in 1911, and this is the front of this realization, and you can appreciate also down there the skyline of the old city on the hills, the UNESCO site, and this road that is the big perspective from the funicular to the railway station. And this is a final step in 1917. It was necessary to ask to the central authorities of the state through a royal decree the national approval of this plan to authorize the compulsory purchase of the residual non-collaborating owners of cadastral lots involved in the transformation. The light blue ones, they are resisting. they didn't want to sell their lots to the municipality to allow this transformation, and so the municipality needed to ask for the national royal decree approval to be authorized to the compulsory purchase of this last. But then the transformation was ready to happen. But this is a story that has a long past. Hmm? I selected some previous plans from a really long series of these. This is a project by the engineer Giuseppe Bornigotti in the final part of the 19th century. You can appreciate the first arrangement, the first proposal for the arrangement of the area, and you can also appreciate here the traces, as in a palimpsest, the traces of the existing building of the fair of Bergamo to be removed from the new realization. And the same but different perspective and front, and architectural details of this transformation. 1 year later, another proposal from another engineer, more dense, a denser solution with more important buildings and details of this proposal, the theater. And finally, in the same year, the first municipal plan that tried to sum up these private proposals, try to reorganize the ideas for this area. But they decided to have a contest, a design competition to join the final solution. And as I said, the winner was Marcello Piacentini with Giuseppe Quaroni. But this is another participant. And it is interesting, this proposal, not just for the kind of square and different layout, but because he located this transformation in the rearrangement of the entire city with the opening of these new roads colonizing the plain in this internal ensemble. And so we are ready to address this topic, that is the in-between expansion of the city. This is a plan of the same year, 1892 was rich of planning proposal, not just for the fair area, but also for the entire plain to be organized. With this proposal is a plan made of streets, new streets. And this idea was refined with the first general plan of 1900, in which you can appreciate what was the attempt to link together all the fragments of the city through this new system of streets, of roads, to organize the urbanization process. And the other obsession is rearranging the old city, the walled city. In this fast modernization attempt, there was a part of the planning culture that was convinced that the old city was an obstacle to modernity. And so this is the same professional that I mentioned before, Giuseppe Chitò, one of the participants also to the contest for the new center of the city. His proposal is to realize a wide, straight road through the urban fabric of Bergamo Alta. So large, so wide, to have the possibility to host the tramway. The tramway from the station of the funicular here through the entire body of the historic city. This is a detail. But 30 years later, a totally different perspective. This is one of the most appreciated plans for historic cities of that period by engineer Luigi Angelini, that was celebrated by Gustavo Giovannoni as one of the best use of the techniques of pruning and thinning out, diradamento edilizio. And so, also here we have the attempt to better the urban fabric, opening new voids to provide fresh air to boost circulation and so on, but with the minimum of demolition areas, these ones, and also realizing a new street passing through the voids of the urban fabric to try to save the main part of the urban fabric, not just monuments, but also the banner urban fabric of the city. This is the first proposal of 1927, and this is the following one, or the final one, the approved one, in 1934. So, summing up this first phase in the construction of the modern city, urban planning is a spatial, is a physical matter. And urban plans are substantially the preview of the next city. We don't need a key, we don't need legends to understand these plans. Because drawings are the foreseeing of the expected new urban landscape, are immediately the communication of the message of the urban plan is immediate to the public through the drawing of the expected transformation. Something is changing in the making a modern city phase two. That is the phase of the second World War period. It's the main period related to the construction of the industrial city, and with a city that starts to know a metropolitan dimension. And so also the topics start to change. Overcoming the railway is the one of the new obsessions of Implement. Implementing the road network for this city that is overcoming the barriers, the previous barriers. Organizing the outdoor development of the city through zoning techniques. And also redefining the relationship between the new and old city. The historic center becomes a safeguard zone of the city, available urban area, but somehow subtracted to the modern city life. Something that is put down there, up the hills, but not so involved in the modern city life. And this is very, very clear in the first general plan of the after-war period, that what is interesting in the history, in the internal history of urbanism of Bergamo, that is planners are important planners. I mentioned before Marcello Piacentini, Luigi Angelini. I skipped the name of the author of the first plan of the city at the very beginning of the century, Aristide Caccia, the author of one of the first handbook in planning in Italy, that imported the lesson of Stubbe in Italy. And now a plan signed by Giovanni Muzio, the designer of the Triennale di Milano, if you know the building, and Mario Morini, one of the first teachers in planning techniques at Politecnico di Milano. There is a huge atlas in the history of planning authored by Mario Morini. In this plan, the city is described as constricted in its own physical limits. And the aim of the new plan is to open the city to the urban growth. And in the first page of the general report of this plan, the main aim is defined as follows. To unlock, sbloccare la città, to unlock the city beyond the railway and towards the west and the east side. And this is the drawing. You can appreciate the change also in the representation of planning. This is the station, the railway yards, and this is the new city. And a totally new problem. And the protagonist is the organization of the new framework, the new network of streets, and the new residential areas, and the new productive ones. And nothing else for the rest. Here, okay, we use the regulation code to manage the existing city, and for the old city, nothing. Just one line of text in the very beginning of the general report. Please continue to use the plan of the 30s for that. So, parallel tracks. There is no relationship. And the new important novelty in planning, the key, the legend. Now, to understand planning moves, we need a code to interpret the message of the urbanists. And the other, I have shown to you the printed versions of this plan, but there is also the original drawings. There are also the original drawings. And this is the series of drawings that make this plan more detailed. Okay, the island of the old city, so is a reserve, and the regulation for that stay away. And the new obsession, overcoming the railway, so ideas about new bridges and tunnels, and the implementation process, the progressive implementation scheme to realize this new road network. Then, one step beyond the metropolitan dimension. We are at the, in the 60s, and Bergamo projected in a metropolitan, in the metropolitan territory, and a new obsession, the third center of Bergamo. So the old city, the first center, the Centro Piacentiniano, the second center for the modern city, modernization phase one, and now in a metropolitan way of viewing perspective, the need of a new location, a relocation of the center, and a new obsession that is the third center of Bergamo. And I already underscored this aspect, a special language for urban planning representation. In Muzio Morini, okay, the legend about, I don't know, 20 different items, but now in the plan, in this very, very famous plan, Giovanni Astello and Luigi Dodi, in 1979 municipal approval and final approval 1973, the core aspect of this plan is to recognize a wider planning area involving the entire regional area of Bergamo, to explore and define new territorial limits in their socio-economic internal trends and in the relationship with the outer territory. This is the new essential content of in preparing this new plan, this new general plan, to provide a clear framework, also to plan the central city of Bergamo. It was needed to have this wider vision. And in the words of Giovanni Astello, this was the main operation in the works for this plan. So, in my opinion, says Giovanni Astello, this elaboration represented the most interesting phase, because it required new techniques to test the strong linkage between economic studies about the evolution of the local economy and planning, and urban planning. And inside of this general program, the realization of a new center for the city, the new metropolitan CBD, that is one of the aspects so stressed by this plan. Starting from the old city, passing through the Piacentini city center, and arriving to the new city center that I'm going to show to you in the drawings. Regional exploration of the city, different schemes, central poles, linear expansion along axes, then to try to sum up in two general metropolitan frameworks, to arrive to the municipal plan, and this is the representation of the location of the new CBD, these bubbles, is the place of the new CBD, and this is the legend of this plan. I think 107-110 lines. A little exercise that I propose my students 15 years ago, cutting all the lines and giving to each one of them these strips. Okay, try to reorganize according to criteria. Just once I tried this exercise because they hated me. So I renounced it. Okay, but now we are entering the last phase from the, so after 1972 we enter a new phase, population decline, the after the growth, after the end of the modern city, industrial decommissioning processes. So, transformation processes from inside the city through opportunities for so-called urban projects. Something that is so common to the different countries, each one with its own rhythm, but countries in Europe. And an attention for the urban materials of our contemporary palimpsest. The generic city, this urban explosion made by fragments, the stratified palimpsest of our urbanization, and a new challenge that is looking for a recompositional criteria to reorganize this legacy of urbanization, old and so recent. Explosion of fragments. And so, in the plan that I'm going to show to you finally, the idea was to try to rearrange the restructuring of the contemporary city through systems that are not functional systems. I'm going to show to you. This plan is was realized first approval in 1995, and in 2000 the final regional approval. Bernardo Secchi and Vittorio Gandolfi are the designers, are the planners. Vittorio Gandolfi was the head officer of the municipality, and Bernardo Secchi the main consultant. Some points. Caring for the performance of the urban materials that make in its little grains the contemporary city. Try to combine them in frameworks, systems, qualifying system to gain livability targets. And on the other hand, what is quite renowned is an approach to recomposition to the recomposition of the city that looks at transformation areas as restructuring potential through projecting over. And what does it mean? Drawn rules to manage the urban transformation of priority areas in the city reorganization. And here you can find a definition from the words of the planners about what is a progetto norma, but I'm going to show to you because it is more clear. But let's start from systems. Systems are not functional systems, they start from the physical materials that make these bodies, and here you have the first representation, but in my opinion is more communicative, this one that try to subdivide the different systems. The most interesting one, in my opinion, is this one, system of the central places of the city. And that organized, for sure, we could have some suspicions about that, for sure, probably, the Centro Piacentiniano is involved,
yeah,
but also the World City, yeah, but then we have also the local centralities of the cities, Orange, and so this idea of central places through, and the Sentirone, the historic ancient path, as one of the skeleton of the backbone of the places where we could live together in the city. And then I leave to your deepening these aspects, because I want to conclude showing to you something related to the Progetti Norma. I don't remember how many they are in the plan of Bergamo, more than 20. One is this, is related to how to manage the railway yards, this obsession of the third center, and how it was managed by the plan, the detail, and then an urban project to investigate the potentials in the transformation of the area. So with a program of different possible land use and characterizations, studying path, roads, accessibility, and so on. An urban project to explore in the details. And finally, selecting just essential indications, essential elements of this exploration through urban design tools to fix some required ingredients for the following design development phase of the area. Right, wrong, I'm not interested today to deepen this idea. So there are a mess of pages and debates about this, but so it was about the change of thinking and the change of doing the urban plans in this in this period. I leave to your reading the definition from the plan of the concept of system and of the concept of Progetto Norma. And I'm going to conclude on this. In this last part of the 20th century, a return of interest for the materiality of space, a renewed but different return of interest for the physical form and the physical properties of territory, for the quality of urban space. And this is reflected both in planning tools and in the representation ways of the plan. And we should do another step from redevelopment, that is what I try to explore with this last case, to urban regeneration, sustainable urban regeneration. But the 20th century is finished, and this is a story of the beginning of the third millennium, and also my time expired. Thank you.